Allahu Akbar.
The rebel fighters here in Benghazi, and you see them everywhere, would certainly identify with our next story. It's about a resistance leader who fought for many years, leading his forces against overwhelming odds. I'm referring to East Timor's leader, Xanana Gusmão. Dateline's Mark Davis, no stranger to East Timor, has secured exclusive footage of Gusmão's capture by Indonesian forces in 1992. Here's Mark.
Government headquarters, Dili, East Timor. Xanana Gusmão's days are now full of the niceties and formalities that prime ministers everywhere must endure or enjoy. But 20 years ago, he was leading a very different life. Then he led the armed struggle against Indonesian occupation from the jungles and mountaintops of East Timor.
Hoje, quando muitos governos deviam envergonhar-se da sua cumplicidade no genocídio perpetrado em Timor-Leste pelos indonésios.
Gusmão and his guerrillas were the biggest thorn in Indonesia's side as Indonesia sought to legitimise their occupation of East Timor. Soon after Xanana filmed this message to the world from a jungle hideout, he would be facing his darkest hour, surrounded, captured and imprisoned for life. His troops and the movement they supported flung into disarray with the loss of their famous or infamous leader.
And if you see something, you talk and...
Xanana's 1992 capture and the remarkable interrogation that followed were filmed. A film that has long been assumed to be lost. But this incredible footage has now been leaked to us from inside the Indonesian army and screens for the first time tonight on Dateline.
I could not believe, because I never thought that they will release this.
Xanana has seen some of this footage privately before agreeing to be filmed.
The first time that I saw it was wow.
Now he watches it in its entirety for the first time.
Next year will be 20 years.
20 years. You look like a boy. How old were you in this one then?
Yeah, 20 years, 40. I was 40, yeah, 45.
Seriously, you look about 25 in this one.
Wow.
He watches the film begin in the base of the Kapasas Special Forces as they prepare to strike at the house he's been secretly living in.
They're getting ready, I think.
Yeah, the preparation.
Xanana had been hiding in this house in Dili for weeks, smuggled into town to arrange a weapons shipment and conducting his business from an underground bunker hidden beneath a trapdoor in one of the cupboards.
My place was...
underneath.
Underneath. Yes.
In the underworld.
Yes. People go there, they will not note, absolutely.
But on November 20, 1992, it seems someone did know. Indonesian special forces who were gathering outside.
I started to hear when they approached the house and started talking in Indonesia. Usually when the dogs bark, we know that there is strange people.
Yeah.
I immediately went down.
Underneath?
Underneath.
Crunching feet on the driveway would be enough to disturb Xanana and no doubt terrify the man who owned the house and was hiding him, Augusto Pereira, remarkably an officer in the Indonesian police force.
This is my home on the list.
Yeah.
This is my dog.
Augusto is reliving the moment his life fell apart. Those feet on the driveway, the barking dogs, signalled the collapse of his world as he knew it. These few minutes of video heralding the years of torture that were to follow. Abuse, imprisonment, and the collapse of his family.
I have time for you.
The team began to search the house, but they knew what they were looking for. A hidden trapdoor in a cupboard leading down to a bunker.
If they open, I was...
Just waiting. You're watching.
I was watching. Okay, I'm here.
What were you thinking as they were about to come in? Were you going to fight or surrender?
It took time. It took maybe it took only 5 minutes, but it seemed
forever.
Oh, an eternity. But I was thinking, because I had a machine gun there, I said, I resist or not? And I had time enough to make a choice. I said, if I resist, I'll be a hero. He's dead, a hero. But everybody surrounding here will be killed. And I put the hypothesis to, I surrender.
Very happy.
Xanana was a trophy catch. Rather than being shot and dumped at sea, after posing for photos, word was sent immediately to the head of the Indonesian army in Jakarta.
I believe that they will not hurt me, they will not kill me, because they would like to use me.
Xanana was whisked away to await the arrival of General Tri Sutrisno, handcuffed, given a cup of tea, and interviewed by an intelligence team who appear to have come straight from the tennis courts. Meanwhile, back at the house, the search was on through Xanana's possessions.
Dengan beberapa bendera, di antaranya PBB punya, kemudian senjata.
Every weapon, secret document, radio transmitter found was a potential death sentence for Augusto Pereira.
Pistol.
And he is seeing the full extent of what they uncovered for the first time.
They're finding the guns and evidence and things.
Yes, that's right, yeah.
It was all there.
Yes, all.
Barang-barang ini didapat di rumah Bapak Polisi. Kok itu siapa tadi itu?
Agusto.
Agusto.
Agusto Pereira.
Augusto had gone to work on the morning of the raid. He was on this road teaching other policemen traffic duties when an unmarked army car pulled up behind him.
7 o'clock, he came after me. You have name Augusto Pereira? I say, yes, my name is Augusto Pereira. Now he go.
This was police or Capasas?
Capasas.
Augusto was dragged off to a military compound, his nightmare just beginning as General Tri Sutrisno, head of the Indonesian Armed Forces, arrived in Dili from Jakarta. Cameras rolling as he congratulates his troops and prepares to interrogate his old foe, Xanana Gusmão. With a dozen or so generals watching, an astounding exchange begins between captor and prey. Sutrisno offers his catch one last chance to accept integration. Everyone in the room knows that a public statement from Xanana could end the war, but his reply wasn't a helpful one. With his freedom and possibly his life at stake, Xanana remarkably continues to pick at Indonesia's most sensitive sore, the illegality of their occupation under international law.
Right, because the international law recognizes the right.
While this exchange was happening, Augusto's ordeal was beginning. He had nothing to offer the Indonesians, just a vehicle for fury to be vented, the more customary treatment for East Timorese prisoners.
What happened to you?
My friends, I know say this because I know say it because I suffering all over, but yeah, little bit. Here, Indonesian army put on the core under my here, yeah, put on the yeah
a
like
a noose, a cord
right here.
Yeah,
here. Electricity.
Electricity.
Electricity. Put under here, put under my in, yes, under my head.
Augusto returns to the military compound he was tortured in, now a building depot.
I no have clothes, all over. I like a baby.
Yeah.
This water from toilet. Put together water. Under here.
Up to here.
Yeah. I sleep under here, I no sleep 3 months.
They put you in a toilet, in like a sewer?
Like toilet, all air toilet.
They put, just to lie down or stand up?
No, I'm sitting up.
Sitting up like this.
No go sleeping, what do you sleep?
This house of horrors was separate from the official prisons in Dili and the prying eyes of any international visitors.
I never come back here.
Never.
Because I very angry. This place. Many people die here. How many people Timorenses die here? I don't know how many.
Xanana Gusmão well knew that his own fate lay at the whim of Tri Sutrisno.
Now Xanana can die.
Eu já afirmei que posso ir a tribunal toda a vida. Posso receber os choques elétricos de todas as pessoas que têm sido obrigadas. Posso. Para resolver a questão da questão vocal, da consciência lá no sul.
It seems that the general didn't get the answers he was hoping for, and the meeting is brought to an end.
saya statement saya ini Anda renungkan supaya nanti Anda bisa juga bisa menyadarkan semua saudara-saudara kita yang di gunung. Jadi tidak ada gunanya mereka mimpi bantuan dari luar negeri karena Timur-Timur sudah menjadi tanggung jawab seluruh rakyat Indonesia termasuk rakyat Timur-Timur.
Xanana Gusmão was sent to trial in Jakarta and was sentenced to life.
Here, interrogation and here, all over.
Augusto Pereira was held and tormented here for a year, then imprisoned for another 6 until the Red Cross negotiated his release.
My wife, my grandmother, all over, my son, my daughter, all did come in this house.
This was a terrible place.
This is a terrible place.
His wife and kids were released, but the family never reunited. Augusto lives alone, one of the thousands of bit players who gave their lives or part of them for what seemed an impossible dream.
At this time, did you ever imagine that you would win? Did you ever think you would win?
Yes. Viva Timor!
Viva
Falindeu! Mark Davis reporting. There's a fact file on East Timor and all the countries we feature on our website. Go to sbs.com.au/dateline.